Joining me this Sunday is Martin Fry, who will be talking about ABC's 40th anniversary live collector's album, The Lexicon of Love, to be released on the 19th of May. Vessel number 9, nostalgic 80s funk soul brand, housing the finest videos, stories and interviews from key movers and shakers in this defining era of audio magnitude, including funk soul DJ-led events, showcasing precision playlists and much more. Across the globe, welcome to On the Sofa with Esther. Well, today with me, I have the absolute privilege of inviting Martin Fry from ABC, Shoot That Poison Arrow. That's one of my favorites, that's why I keep relating to that, onto On the Sofa with Esther. Welcome, Martin.
Thanks for inviting me, Esther. I like your sofa.
Thank you. Well, I'm going to do lots of great, nice things to it in the background once we finish with that. That's why I've got those wonderful things.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you. And you are in Barbados, my hometown, my home place, enjoying the sun. And can you speak Bajan? Have you picked up any of the lingo?
Couple of words on my travels, yeah, with my friends here, yeah. I'll tell you what I have done. I've managed to get in the sea this morning. Yeah, that's a great feeling. To start the day after a bathe in Gibbs Beach, feels good.
Excellent.
I love Barbados. Yeah, spend as much time as I can. Sometimes go to Miami, jump across. Got lots of friends, lots of Bajan friends here. Yeah.
Okay, so as they say, is one a wee.
Yeah, I'm an honorary Bajan. They tell me. I don't know.
Nice. I'm glad you're enjoying yourself. Well, Martin, what we're going to talk about today is The Lexicon of Love.
Yeah.
It's a live recording that was recorded last year, and you've got being released on the 19th of May. And yeah. So what we're going to do, we're going to talk about that album. It's got 22 tracks on it. And they're about, you know, I love all of your stuff, but there's five in particular that's always been close to my heart. You know, When Smokey Sings, The Poison Arrow, The Look of Love, All of My Heart, and Flames of Desire. Five of my favorites, because I remember in the 80s, you know, bouncing around to people like yourself, Spandau Ballet, and all those other incredible groups. So over to you. What has it been like to get to, it's 41 years this year?
Well, originally, yeah, the band formed in Sheffield all those years ago. Yeah, we kind of figured we wanted pop music and rock and roll, our music to be a lot more dance floor and a lot more polished and sharp. We were coming out of the sort of post-punk era back then. And there was a lot of bands formed in Britain that were thinking along similar lines. Guys like Duran Duran, I suppose, and the Human League, ourselves, Culture Club,
yeah.
So you'd kind of go to clubs. I'd listen a lot to, Joy Division and the Cure, but I'd also loved Motown and Stax, Atlantic, all those kind of great records that came out of those labels, Chic, Sister Sledge, Earth, Wind and Fire. So it was kind of an attempt with our music to kind of forge those two worlds with using strings, bass and drums, you know, lots of different styles. And out of that came songs like The Look of Love and Poison Arrow.
Yeah.
That was 40 years ago. More recently, I mean, it's just flown by. But I mean, I've been in the last 10 years, I've been playing a lot of shows all around the world with the band and then the South Bank Symphonia, full orchestra, about 40 people, and Dudley conducting. And we've kind of evolved that show. So when somebody said to me it was 40 years since we first put out an album, we're playing Sheffield City Hall, where it all started, it felt right to record that night last year, June 21st. And to record it and put it out as a live album. And that's where the 22 tracks come from, yeah. It's a recording of The Lexicon of Love, the album we put out back then, plus a whole bunch of other stuff through the years. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that's how it's evolved, really. That's how I've got the best job in the world, standing in front of an orchestra, feeling the air move. You know, when the violins play and the viola and the cellos, you can really feel the movement. And being on stage, a lot of music is to track these days, but it is not, with what we do, it's always been great to play everything live. So you just get that kind of collective will, that everybody pulling in the same direction, together on stage, all those musicians. So I wanted to showcase that in our recording. Yeah, and that's why, that's where ABC Live in Sheffield City Hall came about. Yeah.
And what about the audience, you know, to be in that space, like you said, to be center stage with your mic, with all this incredible, I would say, musical magic going on around you, Martin, and then you're also connecting with the audience. And I believe for a lot of them, it must be this place of nostalgia. And I know that in one of the briefs, you said it's about being in the here and now. But then we also have to understand people who've followed you for years, you've been part of our lives. And so there is that moment of nostalgia sitting there watching you. How does that feel for you?
About 10 years ago, I played the Albert Hall and I realized, I mean, after years, late 90s, the hits had dried up, but you're still out there playing the shows. You go through kind of a lot of different periods, you know, in the adventure. And I'd kind of steer away from doing things. But we played a show and I looked out and I realized how much it meant to the audience, some of those songs. Mm. You know, time had moved on, but there we were having a great time in that moment. You know, some businesses might have gone belly up. A divorce might have happened. The kids have grown up. A lot of things happen in people's lives. Wonderful things, tough things, challenging things, but a great deal of things happening in love. But to be there singing along to The Look of Love Again meant so much to that audience, and it really brought it home to me. I mean, I think I knew it already, but it really compounded with me what a privilege it is to get on stage. And that's why the people that I've admired for so long, growing up watching, you know, all the different acts from, you know, James Brown and Marvin Gaye to Dan and Bowie and Roxy and all these different acts, why does Mick Jagger do it? But you realize you learn something fundamental, that to be able to stand on the stage and play your tunes, is your repertoire, is a wonderful feeling. Yeah. But the other thing I did, I sometimes sneak down to the side of the stage and have a little look through the curtains. And when I've noticed, when people come into the shows, it's like, oh, hello, Terry, I've not seen you for 5 years. Yes. People reunite at gigs, don't they? They go, all right, mate, how you doing? And that's a big part of the event, a live event for the audience, the chance to kind of have feel like a community again, you know. Absolutely. So it's kind of a healthy place. For me, nostalgia is a big part of recreating the past, but it's not really about the past. It's about how people feel today. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that's why it feels so good to play all these years on. Maybe I've learned a few tricks of the trade, you know, the showman's handbook, chapter 12, you know. Yeah. Get them up off their seats, you know, and there's a few things you learn along the way as a performer, definitely. In fact, I once went and did the European proms, right? And it was like, it was when I first kind of got back into performing in the late 90s. The hits have stopped, and you learn how to kind of reproject yourself.
Yes.
But Meatloaf was on this gig, and I used to watch him every single night. I did four songs, and they had all this classical. It was in Belgium. It was like a European night of the proms. All these acts are on. Mm. And I used to watch Meatloaf, and he said to me one time, he never leaves the stage until everybody's up on their feet. So I kind of thought, yeah, I kind of like that. Sometimes it would take him 35 minutes doing that. I would do anything for love. In East Germany on a Sunday afternoon, but he would always get them up. And along the way, we opened up for Robbie Williams one time. So I spent the kind of late 90s into the millennium learning the tricks of the trade. Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. After the hits, you learn the tricks.
Do you manage to get them up on their feet most of the times?
Generally, yeah, I say that. Yeah, but no. So actually, I realized people like to sit and watch the show, you know, stand up at the beginning, sit down and stand for the last three songs. Yeah, yeah.
And so, you know, the album, like you said, is 22 tracks, and it's a mix and blend of, you know, more of the known tracks and some of you know, others that might have been in the background. How did you select? What was the process of select? I'm not going to get too psychological, but what was your process of selecting the, you know, all those
other? You've got to play your hits. Got to play the hits. Rule number one, everybody wants to hear the hits. But also there are songs, there are some songs, there's a song called Ocean Blue, which works really well with the orchestra. And I think originally in its DNA, when we were making it on our little synthesizers and string machines, we were imagining, daydreaming of a day when we could present that song in that way. Mm. So it's funny, really. Different songs work in different ways. But I have to say, Anne Dudley is an incredible string arranger, an orchestral arranger. And she's kind of, we didn't want it to be like, oh, there's the band and there's the orchestra and they're battling it out with each other. Yes. It's kind of, the show's evolved musically over the years. That's what we try and, that's in on the record. So, yeah, it's just, you know what? After all these years, it's great to have kind of musical challenges and finding new ways to do things, experimental ways.
Give it a difference. Yeah. It's the same sound, but it's a slightly different sound as well. That's
With the orchestra, it makes everything bigger. It makes everything like widescreen and on steroids or something, you know, it's kind of like, but in a way, a lot of the songs in our repertoire from way back when kind of were yearning for that sort of treatment. Yeah. Something like The Look of Love, All of My Heart had a lot of strings on it anyway, back in the day, when we made the original recording. But yeah, it feels good. Feels right to do it that way now.
And it's interesting because, you know, even watching your videos from way back then, it was also, it was quite theatrical, you know, you were slick suits. Everything was polished, but also it was playful. Does that make sense? There was a there's theatre in the background. It was a fusion of lots of different things and it blended well, though.
The suits, yeah, we always wanted a kind of cosmopolitan edge. I mean, that's kind of influenced by a lot of the sort of 60s bands, I suppose. It comes from, you know, there are some great performers out there that had great tailoring, you know what I mean? And that kind of died. In the 70s, that seemed to disappear for a while. We wanted to bring that back. But yeah, I guess so. But I like things with a sense of humour. And I've never really, it's something about music. Sometimes you get some very po-faced musicians who take it, we all take it seriously, but it's kind of like, no, you know, if you can mix the naivety and the stupidity up with the smart stuff, that's what makes great art. That's all I've always felt. I've never really felt, you know, there are people that sort of think they've got like an overriding understanding of what taste is. I've never really, if they say something's that, I go in the opposite direction. You know what I mean? For my,
yes, absolutely.
You can do that with your fashion clothes, with the food you eat, with the music you listen to, with a vibe. You've got to beat your own rhythm, definitely. The rhythm of your own drum, because there's so many people that try and steal or suggest what you have to do. In fact, as a kid, I think that's why I got into music and bands, because nobody would listen to me as a kid. You know, they'd try and tell me to do stuff all the time and I'd get in trouble because, you know, when they tell me to go there, I'd go there. So I have to say that obstinate stupidity, perhaps, I don't know, but that obstinate defiant spirit has served me very well, especially in the 80s when there were record labels would say to us, don't do that, mate, don't do that. You've got to be like this guy over here. We go, no. We always kind of forged our own original path. We tried to reflect that in the videos, I hope that, I'm glad that, it's very kind of you to say that some of the humour came through,
You can see that, you know, and it was like the subtle playfulness, but it was there, as well as the theatrics. So there was lots in there, but that's what's helped to create, you know, what ABC is about. That just, and you said a key word there, art. You see it as art. And so when you see anything as art or creativity, then you're not locked in a box. You can expand that and you can make it your own.
Music is art, I think. When I think of some of the records that I still carry with me today, you know, I just remember, it can take you through your life, definitely. I've always felt that, Pop music, rock and roll, hip hop, whatever the genre, there's always the stuff in there that really lights your day up, you know. I think that's really important. And I don't know, less so now with social media, but back then it always felt like people would tell you this is, I mean, partly because there was a lot of rock and roll around. And in the 70s, there was a lot of guys in leather trousers and long hair. And we kind of were a different generation coming through. We were rebelling against those guys. Our interests were somewhere else. They were kind of in maybe a more mod thing. I don't know. going to clubs, you know, people, all sorts of different people getting together and uniting. That was a really important part of the music, important part of what you did, going to out on a Wednesday night or on a Saturday night. And you try and take that feeling and put it into your own music. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. That, it's hard to describe.
Creating your own.
I don't know what it's like now, because there's so many different styles available now, aren't there? And so many different different paths people can follow. If you were forming a band or making clothes professionally or painting pictures or whatever, making furniture, there are so many influences at play online.
I guess that's why it makes what you do unique. You know, there's lots of things happening out there, and for a lot of people it's about freedom, it's about expression, but then there's also the uniqueness of certain people, certain bands. You know, they still have their niche. That's it, their little niches, and that's what remains. You know, I believe what you're about, even the way, like you say, you dress, the performance, everything. It's about a look, but not a look in terms of how society would deem a look. Is that making sense, Martin?
Yeah, absolutely. You've got to find your own style.
That's right.
I think so, musically, visually. I mean, singing's a weird thing because it's like a real private thing you do. You're kind of there in a room on your own and the sound comes out. But then you've got to do it in front of 20,000 people, you know what I mean? Or you make a record and it's kind of public property, off it goes.
Yeah.
But I realized the singers I liked, they weren't the people at school were going, oh, yeah, he sings in tune in time. They were just these very individual voices. You know, that's what I like about the people I admire in music, the people that have their kind of, the guts to say, you know what, I'm going to just do it my way. My way, Frank Sinatra said it, didn't he? The people that do it their way, yeah, definitely. And I value that. I think I value originality over anything, really, to take something original, to stand by it and take it forward. That's a great, great, I think I value that more than anything else, yeah. That's how every brand starts in today's world. That's how everything starts, from people sticking to their guns, yeah.
That's one key thing to get.
Anyway, end of speech.
Oh, this has been an interesting conversation.
Professor Martin and his speech on music for the youngsters. Yeah, no.
And so therefore, just tell us a little bit more about the Lexicon of Love. You know, so you've got two CDs as part of that. There's two CDs. There's also three. There's sparkly purple vinyl. I love that.
Yeah, well, the purple vinyl, I've always wanted to do a purple vinyl and the sparkly. It's a bit of a homage to Minneapolis and Prince, I suppose. Yeah, he had the purple rain, obviously, and right. Everything was purple in his world. But yeah, it feels right. ABC can also be purple vinyl too.
That's good, Martin. We give you that. That's good.
Yeah. So it's kind of to showcase what we've been doing now. But I mean, it just feels nice to document what we're doing. Yeah. Yeah. For those people who want to check it out.
Excellent. Excellent. And what's coming up for you, you know, in 2023, other than the release of your Lexicon of Love live?
I'm going to go to Pasadena and play on a festival.
Oh, wow.
With the band. Festivals kind of in California, and then play some shows near San Francisco. It's kind of nice now because I get to play in Germany, in Britain. I'm going to go and do some of those Rewind festivals, which are fantastic fun to do because you kind of get to play on a multi-bill with, you know, you're going to have your coffee and there's OMD, Orchestra Maneuvers, there's Adamant over there, there's the Human League, you know. I always think that back in the day, we're always trying to get to number one on the charts. If you met anybody at Top of the Pops, it was fiercely competitive. You know, everybody was chasing that number one spot. But now it's kind of cool. It's nice to kind of be on the same bill as all these acts and enjoy the company and get up on stage and play some great shows. So I'll play the Rewind Festivals in Manchester, up in Cheshire, sorry, and in by Henley. And there's one up in Scoon Palace in Scotland. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So I've got a whole bunch of shows to play. Yeah. And then probably might dust down the orchestra for next year and get out and about again. Because the orchestral show has been very popular. People enjoy it. It's different for people to come and see. So, you know, yeah, I'm going to be on the road. Yeah.
Excellent.
I'm not on the beach.
That's your private space, not the beach in Barbados. Yeah. That's your private space where you can relax and chill out and enjoy some Asian sun.
Yeah, exactly.
Martin, it's been an absolute pleasure talking to you.
Thanks for inviting me down on the sofa.
Thank you. All right, then. Bye-bye.
All the best.
And gravity won't pull you through. You know you're missing out on something. Well, that something depends on you. All I'm saying, it takes a lot to love you. All I'm doing, you know it's true. All I mean now, there's one thing, yes, one thing that turns this gray sky to blue. That's the look.
Japanese culture, and we're going to have an afternoon tea Japanese expert.